I agreed entirely with the Future Forum when they said in their report last year, we've also heard many people saying that competition and integration are opposing forces. We believe this is a false dichotomy. Integrated care is vital, and competition can and should be used by commissioners as a powerful tool to drive this for patients. That is worth keeping in our minds. In answer to my noble friend, Lord Clement Jones, let me turn to competition law. I understand that some noble lords would like to prevent competition law ever applying to NHS services. That, my lords, is to wish for the impossible. The question is not should competition law apply to the health service, it is how it should be applied. And that's the reason why I agree totally with my noble friend that we must make sure that the NHS is insulated from the inappropriate application of competition law. In particular, we must ensure that clinicians are free to commission NHS services in the way that best serves patients' interests, and that there are no impediments to beneficial cooperation to increase integration, improve quality, reduce inequalities. Under our proposals, a series of protections will provide the sort of insulation against inappropriate application of competition law that my noble friend and others require. And I hope the House will allow me just to set this out in a bit of detail. First of all, the cooperation for the benefit of patients should not breach competition law. Article 101(3) of the Treaty of the Functioning of the European Union and Section 9 of the Competition Act lay down exemptions which apply if the wider benefits of an agreement outweigh its anti-competitive effects. On an individual basis, we would expect collaborative arrangements whose overall effect was beneficial to patients would meet the criteria in Article 101(3) and Section 9. Second, competition law would be unlikely to apply to a wide range of NHS services. Some obvious examples are accident and emergency, trauma, critical care, maternity, specialist surgery, and many others, particularly in remote and rural areas. Thirdly, Monitor would support the NHS to understand where competition law applies and does not apply. A key benefit of establishing Monitor as a sector regulator with concurrent responsibilities under the Competition Act is that it will be able to provide authoritative guidance on where that law would and would not apply. The government's firm expectation is that Monitor would produce sector-specific guidance and address this question in terms of relevant examples, including models of integrated care and clinical networks, which would be updated in line with developments in healthcare practice. And this guidance would help reduce unnecessary fear of legal challenge and help reduce uncertainties for both commissioners and providers. Monitor could also provide informal advice in individual cases, building on what the Cooperation and Competition Panel does now. For example, that might include commenting on what types of collaborative arrangements and specific provisions within such arrangements are and are not likely to comply with the competition rules. Any such advice would be without prejudice to any future decision that Monitor might have to take to enforce the provisions of the Competition Act. But like the guidance, such advice would provide reassurance to providers and could help them avoid unnecessary legal costs. Fourth, if and when it became appropriate, Monitor could make the case for block exemptions. And that would mean that the Competition Act wouldn't apply to specified arrangements for the provision of NHS services. Now, at this stage, it isn't clear whether or where block exemptions might be appropriate, but an example of the sort of arrangement that could potentially be covered is clinical networks. In any event, this protection would remain available, and there is no doubt in my mind that Monitor would be better placed than the OFT to determine when and where it might be needed. Now, in these and other areas, competition is unlikely to be effective in providing services on the scale or in the way in which best promotes patients' interests. The NHS often acts to promote social objectives, to ensure that patients receive a level of service that they could not afford, or which private companies might not find it profitable to provide. Applying competition law in such contexts makes little sense, and such activities are likely to fall outside of its scope. Next, commissioners would not have to create markets against the interests of patients. Clinicians will be free to commission services in the way that they consider best. And we intend to make clear that commissioners will have a full range of options and that they will be under no legal obligation to create new markets, particularly where competition would not be effective in driving high standards or value for patients. As I've already explained, this will be made absolutely clear through secondary legislation and supporting guidance as a result of the bill. The bill already creates duties on commissioners to secure continuous improvement in the quality of services, reduce inequalities, and promote integrated services. The government intends to complement these by making it explicit through regulations under Clause 73 of the bill that commissioning decisions must be in the best interests of patients. And those decisions must be transparent, and commissioners will be accountable for them. We would expect the NHS Commissioning Board to maintain guidance to support commissioners in these decisions based on the available evidence and drawing on academic research. It's worth reflecting that without Part 3 of the bill, the main legal provision on commissioning NHS services would continue to be the general procurement regulations for public bodies introduced by the previous administration in 2006. The application of that law to the NHS is unclear. Without the provision that we intend to include in regulations under Clause 73, commissioners would continue to face risk of legal challenge when they decided not to open services up to competition, even where the decision was in the best interest of patients. That uncertainty, in our view, is unacceptable. Finally, the bill would prevent private companies taking over NHS trusts or foundation trusts. There's been a lot of misconception about that. And I can assure the House today, unequivocally, that that could not happen. I will turn, if I may, to the opposition amendments. Amendment 163D raises the issue of the application of competition law to the provision of NHS services. Its intention is to ensure that competition law doesn't apply to the provision of NHS services, but as I've said, there is a basic point to make here. It isn't within the gift of this bill to secure that. It is like saying that if you pass a law saying that black is white, then that is what will happen.